Views in Interpretation of Culture Reports by Dr. Tanu Singhal. And the chairperson for this session are Dr. Pankaj Garg. Dr. Pankaj Garg is a senior consultant department of neonatology, Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. Dr. Tapisha, she is a very senior consultant at Max Patpagan Hospital, and a very and the third chairperson is Dr. Rekha. She is a senior consultant and in charge pediatric critical care at BLK Super Special Hospital, New Delhi. Over to you, chairperson.
Dr. Rachna Sharma.
Rachna Sharma, sorry.
Rachna Sharma.
Yes, Rachna Sharma. So over to you, Dr. Chairperson, Dr. Pankaj. Please introduce the speaker for the day.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Rajiv, for this session. Though last, but it is one of the very important sessions because as an intensivist, we always say you need to believe the cultures which you send. And who better than Dr. Tanu Singhal to dwell on this point? Dr. Tanu is a very senior consultant intensivist at Kokilaben Hospital, Mumbai. And in this COVID time, I'm sure all of us have listened to her talks on COVID, but today is a different day. So we are going to listen to her on the topic of blood culture. So it's over to you, Dr. Singhal.
Thank you. Thank you. And I would like to thank Dr. Shyam Kukreja for inviting me to make this presentation. And I hope I will try and wind up early because, you know, we are already, you know, so I'll try and finish in time. But I thought that going through it systematically is important to make people understand the nuances of, you know, culture and sensitivity testing. So we all know that culture and sensitivity. Can you see me and hear me?
Yes, we can.
Fine, ma'am. Yeah. Please go ahead.
Yeah, my video is not on, sorry.
Now we can see you.
Yeah. So we know that culture and sensitivity is the gold standard for microbiologic diagnosis, and importantly, it gives us the susceptibility info. And therefore, it is important to know about conventional culture methods, about new methods and techniques, and also know about when to send cultures, when not to send cultures, how to interpret in light of the patient's condition. And in today's presentation, we will mainly discuss analysis of smear because the AFB or the Gram stain has important bearing in diagnosis, and it is part of the culture report. We will analyze bacterial cultures in today's presentation, not fungal and mycobacterial cultures. And we will spend quite a bit of time on antibiotic susceptibility analysis because that is particularly important for intensivists, I think, which, and you know, there are many in this audience. So before I go to the culture and sensitivity, I just want to tell you what is the usual workflow in the microbiology lab. So what happens is that when blood cultures are sent, we have to send at least one set. And we have to inoculate it into both the aerobic and anaerobic bottle. And people will ask why anaerobic cultures, because we're not routinely suspecting anaerobic organisms. But it is because some of the streptococci and some of the gram-negative bacteria grow better in anaerobic medium because they are actually facultative anaerobes. That is why you should send both. And we should send about 1% of the circulating blood volume, which would approximately be maybe 10 ml in a 5 to 6 ml in a 10 kg child. And this is inoculated into blood culture bottles. Now, when you have pus, CSF, or other body fluids like pleural fluid, peritoneal fluid, etc., you can inoculate it directly into the blood culture bottles. And that is important because that increases the sensitivity of these infections in these areas. And at the same time, you will also subject it to various kind of smear testing like Gram stain, AFB stain, KOH mount for fungi, wet mount in case it's a urine specimen or a fluid specimen, and India ink if it is the CSF where you want to pick up cryptococcus. And you, apart from that, you will also inoculate these into the solid media. And when you have swabs, urine, sputum, then you will directly inoculate it into solid media. You will not be injecting them into the blood culture bottles. And you can also subject the sputum to all these stains. Of course, swabs you can't subject to the stain, and that is why swab is not a good method or a good specimen for microbiologic diagnosis, because you can't do a gram stain and you can't inoculate it into a culture bottle, and the amount of material which you have is very little. Now, what happens is nowadays all these blood culture systems are automated systems in which the machine, the bottle goes into a machine and the machine is constantly detecting the growth in the bottles. And whenever there is some growth which happens in the bottle, it flags positive. So the what the lab technician will do is, where there is a 24-hour technician available, they will take a little bit of the sample from the bottle and make a smear. And that is how, you know, they will tell you that your patient is growing GNB or your patient is growing GPC. And when now what they do is that they inoculate this material to the solid media, because you need the re-inoculate it into solid media to come to know what pathogen and what is its susceptibility. Then the colonies appear in 24 hours, and then you will pick up these colonies. And earlier, like, used to identify organisms by doing various kinds of biochemical tests, and you would do susceptibility testing by disc diffusion. Nowadays, all these things go into Vitech systems. These are automated systems where you just put the colony inside, and soon you will get, you'll know what the ID is and what is the susceptibility. And also, you must remember that if you have the facilities from the bottle itself, you can run certain molecular panels, like you have the BCID panel from BioMérieux, which will give you a quick identification of what bacteria or fungus it is. And similarly, you can also do these molecular panels from colonies, and you can also take up material from the colonies and do a quick identification through MALDI-TOF, because that takes only about an hour. Whereas if you actually do it through the Vitech, it takes longer time. But you must understand that through MALDI-TOF, you know the identification of the organism, but you don't know the susceptibility of the organism. So this is just to tell you how things flow in the microbiology lab. And though you say that the culture reports come to you after 48 hours, if you are having good dialogue with your microbiology colleague, then every few hours you can get an update about your sample to know what is it growing and what is the progress. Now, the first thing which you need to look at when you see a culture report or when you have sent a specimen is the gram stain. And it is something which can give a diagnosis in 20 minutes if it is representative. So first thing which you need to do is look at the number of pus cells and epithelial cells. So suppose, you know, there's a specimen, a sputum you have sent, and they say that pus cells are less than 10 per HiPA field and epithelial cells are 25. You know that this is a salivary specimen and this is not a proper lower respiratory tract specimen, and you will not believe the report. Look if there are organisms present on the gram stain. So many times it will say pus cell seen and gram negative bacilli seen. So the moment you start seeing organisms on the gram stain, it tells you that the bacterial load is high. That means more than 10,000 per mil. And the likelihood of what is grown is a pathogen and not a colonizer. So because only when an organism is present in large quantities, you get a gram stain positive. So the presence of organisms tells you what bacteria it is, at least initially. And it will also help you distinguish between a colonizer and a pathogen. And which kind of gram stain reports are useful in clinical practice? For example, gram stain of CSF and other fluids. If you see gram positive diplococci, you know you could be dealing with pneumococcus. Expectorated sputum in a child, not an antimicrobial therapy, where it will tell you what is the cause of community acquired pneumonia. This is more possible in children who have bronchiectasis or older children. Gram stain of freshly centrifuged urine for bacteria, and you know, studies indicate that a positive gram stain has very high sensitivity and specificity for diagnosis of a UTI, and gram stain of pus or biopsy samples. And you can start empiric therapy on the basis of the gram stain also, because you know the final report will come after 24 to 48 hours. Now, let me just discuss a few cases with you. So this is a young female who had osteopetrosis, and she underwent dental extraction, and she had multiple sinuses which were discharging pus. And these pus was foul smelling. It was non-healing. She had received multiple antibiotics. And if you look at the gram stain here, you see these gram-positive bacilli, which you can see, because these are gram-positive because they are purple in color and they are bacilli. So actually, this was a case of cervicofacial actinomycosis. And the diagnosis was made on the gram stain because we tried to culture the specimen in anaerobic media, but we couldn't, because this is a fastidial organism, doesn't grow well on culture. And because of the gram stain, we were able to make a diagnosis and treat the patient with antibiotics, which she needed obviously for a period of 12 months. So here, the gram stain gave us a diagnosis, whereas the culture could not. Now, the other thing is about the AFB stain. Now remember, it is a protocol in many labs or most of the labs to stain all pus body fluids for acid pus bacilli, even when TB is not suspected. So in our lab, for example, and in many other labs like Hinduja, even though you will ask for a gram stain, the lab will do an acid fast stain free of cost, because they have realized that in many instances in India, you actually have TB as a possible cause. And it is very rewarding. And when you see acid fast bacilli, remember that they are not always MTB. They can be Mycobacterium bovis, they can be non-tuberculous mycobacteria, or they can even be nocardia. Now, let us look at this patient. This was a child who undergoes a laparoscopic appendicectomy. 3 weeks later, the patient has pus discharged from the port site and the pus gram stain is negative. But because there was a protocol in the lab to look for AFB, AFB smear, Zeal Nelson's was done and the AFB smear was positive. And the patient was actually started on anti-TB treatment. Now, which kind of tuberculosis is going to present with pus discharge from an abdominal surgery site? That is because everybody thinks that if you find acid fast bacilli, it is MTB. But this could actually be a case of non-tuberculous mycobacterial infection, because these, you know that you can get these infections following use of laparoscopes because of inadequate sterilization. And the one way to differentiate is to ask the lab what are the acid fast bacilli looking like. So if they are short and stocky, it is NTM. If they are long and beaded, it is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now, in this patient, the expert was negative, and the MTB cultures, they showed non-tuberculous mycobacteria, and it was identified finally by line probe assay as M. chironi and treated appropriately, and the child got well. So just think of whether if this patient would not have undergone an AFB smear of the pus, we would have missed the diagnosis. And that is why it is very important that you have to keep your mind open, and labs should do AFB smear also on all pus samples. Now, so that was, I discussed two cases where we could make the diagnosis by gram stain and AFB stain. Now, once you once the report tells you about the organism, you have to remember that a positive culture is, though it's a gold standard, these organisms which you grow on culture can actually be true pathogens. They may be contaminants or they may be colonizers. And it is important that these are interchangeable. So what is true pathogen in one setting can become colonizer in another. And we will discuss these things as we go along with some cases. Now, in blood cultures, what are the organisms which you grow in the blood culture are usually true pathogens. So all gram-negative bacteria, suppose you grow E. coli, you grow Klebsiella, you grow Acinetobacter, or you grow Pneumococcus, you grow HIP, or you grow Staph aureus, these are true pathogens. And another important property of a true pathogen is that it will fit with the clinical condition. Can I please request the other people to mute themselves?
Dr. Gaba,
Rohit, please mute everyone except ma'am. Rohit, please do that.
Okay. That is an important property. So you grow what you have been expecting to grow. Whereas contaminants are those organisms like coagulase negative staph, diptheroids, they grow after 48 hours and a single bottle is positive. And that is why, it's always important to send a set of blood cultures, because if you grow it in one bottle and you don't grow it in another, it could be a contaminant. And also what you grow does not fit in the clinical spectrum. And then finally, you can have colonizers. For example, in blood cultures, colonizers can come if you've taken a sample from the central line, because many times the central line is will be colonized with pathogens, but they will not be the actual culprits for the patient's clinical condition. So let us discuss one case. So this is a 10-year-old who comes with high fever of 10 days duration with abdominal pain and some diarrhea. And it is looking like enteric because the white cell count is low. The polys are predominant, platelets are a little low, CRP is high, malaria is negative, blood culture is sent, and this patient is admitted and IV ceftriaxone is started. And 48 hours later, the blood culture grows Burkholderia area sepatia. So again, this is not what you were expecting, because Burkholderia area sepatia is a widely distributed organism which mainly causes nosocomial infections. People who have been in the ICU for a long time on multiple antibiotics, it causes Burkholderia sepatia is the cause. But and also sometimes it is reported as Pseudomonas species. So, you know, when you have a report from the lab in the blood culture saying that it is Pseudomonas species and it is not Pseudomonas aeruginosa, you have to be careful, because what that Pseudomonas species may be is actually it's a contaminant. And in this case, the setting is of enteric fever, Burkholderia does not fit in. So probably this has come because of some contamination during collection of the specimen or in the lab. And these organisms, you know, they don't have great nutrition requirements. So they grow in all these betadine and other bottles. So if you use a contaminated bottle to clean the skin before collecting the blood culture, you will grow these pathogens. So in this situation, you are reasonably confident that you're dealing with enteric. You can dismiss the report and you wouldn't repeat the sample, but at the same time you'll try and find out why this happened. Is there some problem in the way the cultures are being collected in your hospital or in the lab, and you will try and take care of those things so that such kind of contamination does not happen. And this is also the case if a lot of cultures you are sending are growing corns, coagulase negative staphylococcus. You know that there is some problem in the way the specimens are being collected and you have to tighten it up. Now, what if the blood grew Burkholderia pseudobani? So this is a different pathogen. You may think Burkholderia, but Burkholderia pseudomallei is basically causes melioidosis, which is a disease associated with multiple abscesses. And it is not common in children. It's quite common in diabetic adults and alcoholic adults. But remember that when you have when you get a report which shows a rare organism which you haven't heard, you should not dismiss it. But you should always get in touch with your microbiology colleague, and you should also do a Google search to try and find out what this pathogen is and what could be the significance in this particular patient. Now, another point which I wanted to talk about is that contaminants and true pathogens are interchangeable, something which I talked about earlier also. So, for example, a child with fever for 3 to 4 days has a single peripheral line blood culture growing corns. You know it's a contaminant. A child who has aseptic meningitis, you do a CSF and the lab after 48 hours tells you it's growing corns. You know it has come, it is a contaminant. But what if you have a very low birth weight baby in the NICU with sepsis, and in whom you send 2 sets of cultures and 2 out of 4 cultures grow corns? Then you can't dismiss it, because we know that corns or coagulase negative staph or staph epidermidis can be a pathogen in low birth weight babies in the NICU. Similarly, if there is a child who has a prosthetic heart valve and has endocarditis, if he grows corns in 2 sets of cultures, you know that here this is not a contaminant, but it's a true pathogen. Similarly, if you have a child with a VP shunt and you do a shunt tap and it shows a shunt infection and it grows corns, you know that this is not a contaminant, but it's a true pathogen. So that is why you can't label any pathogen, any bacteria as a contaminant. It is basically the setting in which you find that bacteria which tells you whether it's a contaminant or a true pathogen. So corns, which is normally dismissed as a contaminant, can also be a true pathogen. Now, let us look at other specimens like urine cultures. So you have a 2-year-old with high fever. The CBC shows a white cell count of 20,000. The CRP is high. So obviously you're thinking of a bacterial infection. The urine routine has been collected by a bag specimen, which is okay to collect a urine routine which shows 40 pus cells per hyperfield. So you know you're dealing with a UTI. You admit the child and you start the child on IV ceftriaxone. But because you couldn't collect a clean CAT specimen before starting antibiotics and you were in a hurry to start antibiotics, you actually send the urine after 24 hours. And the urine grows Enterococcus faecalis. Now the child is better, but this Enterococcus is resistant to ceftriaxone. So, I mean, is the Enterococcus faecalis causing this patient's UTI? Unlikely, because it's not a common cause of UTI in normal children. So probably what has happened is that you must always collect cultures before starting antibiotics. And if you have a urgency to start antibiotics in a toxic child, you can easily collect this culture by putting in a catheter sample. Now, what has happened here is that the Enterococcus has been selected out as it is inherently resistant to ceftriaxone. So, and the E. coli has gone away. And therefore, this is not a culprit. So, remember that whenever you collect a whenever you have a culture report on a patient who has been already on antibiotics, you could be growing colonizers and not the true pathogen. Now, let us come to a little different case, you know, which was actually very surprising. This is a case of a meningitis. So this was a 9-month-old baby who was previously healthy, had fever, irritability and vomiting for 3 to 4 days. The patient was admitted, had a bulging fontanelle. And the count was normal, but the CSF was done because obviously meningitis was suspected and the CSF had 11,000 cells with 90% neutrophils, high protein and low sugar. So obviously, you know that you're dealing with bacterial meningitis, and this case came in 3-4 years ago where, you know, the empiric therapy for bacterial meningitis was ceftriaxone. So the patient was started on IV ceftriaxone, the fever goes down and 48 hours later, the lab tells you that the CSF is growing this organism, Stenotrophomonas maltophilia, and this is not susceptible to ceftriaxone. Now, Stenotrophomonas maltophilia is also like organism like Burkholderia sepatia, which usually comes in hospital-acquired infections, and this is not a cause of community-acquired infections. So, you know, it is okay to dismiss this as a contaminant. But ceftriaxone was continued, but the patient did not improve. The patient's fever persisted. You do a repeat CSF, the CSF is much better. From 11,000, your cells have gone down to 500. And it has become from predominant polys to predominant lymphos. This protein has gone down. The sugar has improved. So you feel that this patient has got partially better. But clinically, the fever is still persisting. So you again send the culture, this time again to a reference lab. And again, it grows Stenotrophomonas maltophilia, same sensitivity. So then in this case, the treatment is changed appropriately and the patient improves. So what are the learning points from this case? The learning point is that sometimes you will, very, very rarely though, you will encounter pathogens which initially seem like contaminants. You don't believe them because they are not known to cause the problem which your patient has come to you with. But if your patient does not improve with standard therapy, then the test should be repeated. And if you isolate the same organism again, from a reference lab, then you know that this is a true pathogen and you have to treat it as such. And this case which you are seeing is a medical oddity and maybe the case needs to be reported. So very, very rarely you will find this happening, that what you think of is a contaminant actually is the true pathogen. We had one such case, you know, 1-year-old who came with prolonged fever and meningitis, and we thought it was TBM, and we did a CSF into Candida albicans, and we kept thinking that this Candida albicans is a contaminant. We repeated it again into Candida albicans. So that is when we knew that this is actually the culprit and we need to treat it. So whenever you are in doubt, always repeat the test. So there are other instances, you know, when your cultures are misleading and they don't help you in treatment. For example, you have a patient who has fever, sore throat, you start amoxicillin, the patient doesn't get better, you send a throat swab. And then it grows Klebsiella or Pseudomonas. So these are just colonizers because they don't cause sore throat. So they don't have to be treated. Similarly, you have a patient with acute suppurative otitis media who's discharging pus from the ear. 10 times out of 10, if you send a culture from this pus now, it will grow Pseudomonas. Doesn't mean that this is Pseudomonas or otitis media. It is just that it's a colonizer. Because Pseudomonas is a very, very common colonizer because the organism doesn't really need any nutrients for its growth. It can actually grow in water as well. So that is why in lots of places where you have open wounds, or you have open swabs and all you send, you commonly find Pseudomonas over there. It is just a colonizer. Similarly, you have a child with diarrhea who's not improving and you send a stool culture and it will either show you Candida or it will show you ESBL pathogen. And these are misleading because these pathogens are not causing the diarrhea of the patient. The true pathogen, whatever it was, went away with the antibiotics and now you're left with colonizers. Similarly, if you send a urine culture of a patient who's on antibiotics, you grow yeast, but that is not the culprit. Similarly, if your ICU is sending ET cultures in ventilated children and it's growing MDR or XDR pathogens, then these are also the real culprits. And swab cultures from open wounds, drain cultures. So the pleural drain has been there for 3-4 days. And then you send a culture from that pleural drain. It is going to only give you colonizers. And similarly, Foley catheter tip and endotracheal tip culture should never be sent. So remember that when you find an organism, you have to interpret the organism in light of the clinical situation. And you have to differentiate between true pathogens, contaminants, and colonizers. So moving to the last part of the talk, which is interpretation of the antibiotic sensitivity, which is the biggest part of the talk. We have all of us who have read Panikkar in second MBBS have been told about the disc diffusion method or the Kirby-Bowell method, in which, you know, you have a petri dish with a media, you inoculate the media with the organism and you put the antibiotic coated discs. And then basically, there will be a zone of inhibition which will form around the disc. And if the zone of inhibition is large, it means that the organism is sensitive. And if it is small, it means it's resistant. Of course, you will have to compare it to breakpoints, which I will discuss later. But now, these disc diffusion methods have been largely given up. And now you have these automated methods for sensitivity testing, which is, automated systems you have like Vitek, etc., where, you have the machine itself in which you just load a card with the pathogen and it will tell you, because it will use the minimum inhibitory concentration technique. That means what happens is that minimum inhibitory concentration is the minimum concentration of the drug required to inhibit the growth of the organism. And then you have the gradient diffusion or the E-strip methods in which you have an E-strip which is coated with the antibiotic in increasing concentrations and you put it in the petri dish and you will find that there is a zone of inhibition which is shaped like an ellipse. And where the zone of inhibition intersects with the strip, you have the actual MIC. So the advantage of gradient diffusion or E-strip over the dilution methods is that this gives you the exact MIC, whereas this just tells you whether the MIC is lower than the cutoff or not. And of course, you have molecular methods based on detection of resistant genes also, but I will not be discussing that today. So the principle of antibiotic sensitivity testing is to pronounce organisms as sensitive, resistant, or intermediate. And how do you pronounce them as these? By comparing either the zone of inhibition or the MIC to various kinds of breakpoints. So you have a susceptibility breakpoint and you have a resistance breakpoint. And these breakpoints differ for different antibiotics, organism, and various types of societies, like CLSI from the US, UCAS is from Europe, BSAC is from Britain. India, we don't have our own breakpoints, but most of us in India follow the US breakpoints, which are CLSI. And another thing which you must remember is that if your pathogen is sensitive to that antibiotic, your chances of therapeutic success is high. But if it is resistant, the chances of therapeutic success are low but not zero. And that is the reason why often you find that you have used an antibiotic, the patient has got better, but then finally you get the report, it shows that it is resistant. Because what these when the societies set up these breakpoints, they try to be very conservative. So they don't want any resistant isolate to be pronounced sensitive. So that is why they keep their cutoffs like that, while you can pronounce a sensitive isolate as resistant, you can't pronounce a resistant isolate as sensitive. And what if it is intermediate? It means that you can achieve therapeutic success by giving higher doses. So this is just an example, you know. Like, for example, if you use this diffusion, then for E. coli and for the antibiotic ceftriaxone, your sensitivity breakpoint is 28 mm and your resistance breakpoint is 23 mm. So suppose your isolate has shown a disc diameter of 18 mm, it means that it is resistant because it is lower than the resistance breakpoint. That means the zone of inhibition is smaller. Whereas when you look at the MIC, that is on your VITEC, etc. So these are just some examples. For example, for E. coli and ceftriaxone, your sensitivity breakpoint is 1 and resistance is 2. So if your isolate value is 8, means it is resistant. It is higher than the resistance breakpoint. And so also, I just wanted to show you the difference between the various societies. So for example, if you take E. coli and you take piperacillin tazobactam, and if you look at the CLSI breakpoints, this is 16 and this is 128. So that means if your isolate has a MIC of 16, the CLSI will pronounce it as sensitive. But if you have UCAST, if you're applying UCAST breakpoints, then it will pronounce it as intermediate. So that is why, as we will discuss later in this talk, it is important not just to see the result of the sensitivity report, but to actually look at the MIC so that you don't make this mistake of confusing between the two different societies. And this is also true for meropenem by CLSI and UCAS. So for example, here it is ULTA. That means the CLSI breakpoints will say anything less than 1 is sensitive, but anything more than 4 is resistant. Whereas the UCAS will have a higher cutoff. So that means if the isolate has a value of 2, the CLSI will pronounce it intermediate, susceptible, but UCAS will say it is sensitive. So for those people who are treating critically ill patients, not for everybody, it is very important to know the breakpoints and the MIC. And this is just a good app, you know. I've saved some screenshots. So you can go to Google Play Store and you can, it's called, the name of the app is Breakpoint MIC. You can download it. It's a free app. It's you can choose the English version. So you just have to put the bacterium and the antibiotic. So you put the bacterium is Enterobacteriaceae, antibiotic is ceftriaxone. So it will tell you what is the sensitivity breakpoint and what is the resistance breakpoint. But remember that this app only tells you about the UCAST cutoffs. It does not tell you about the CLSI. And for those who are really interested in knowing the breakpoints, they can ask their lab to give them the printout of the CLSI or the UCAST for you to look at the various breakpoints. And something which we should also understand is that it is not enough for us to see whether it is sensitive or resistant, but also look at the MIC. And you calculate the MIC to breakpoint ratio. Now, many times, you know, people tell me that, look, whichever MIC is lowest, that is the best drug. But it's not the actual MIC, but it is the MIC to breakpoint ratio. So, for example, if you have Klebsiella, which has these MICs, if you compare it to breakpoints, you find that the ratio is lowest with meropenem, and that is why this is the best drug. Of course, its MIC is also the lowest, but you can't look at the absolute MIC. You have to look at the MIC breakpoint ratio. Now, coming to some cases, with that basic about antibiotic sensitivity, you have again a child who has a UTI, and you look at the report, and this is a report which is not correct. Nobody should issue a report in the form of pluses, because here it will look, you will see, you think that the one which has the maximum number of pluses is most sensitive. But when you actually compare the zone diameter with the breakpoints, you find that those things which had the maximum pluses are actually resistant, and those which had the smallest pluses are actually sensitive. So this is not the way it has to be reported. So basically, if you look at this urine culture report, it is E. coli, it is ceftriaxone resistant, so it's an ESBL pathogen. Now, but this patient whom you started ceftriaxone, the culture shows resistant to ceftriaxone, but the patient improves. So what would you do in this patient? And that's a very common question which is asked. Modify or continue the same? And the reason why this has happened is because there's a difference between in vitro and in vivo susceptibility and the concentration of drug in urine, and breakpoints are on the basis of serum. So basically the drug gets such high levels in the urine that it overcomes the resistance. And therefore, you such patients, you can continue the same, but you have to watch for late therapeutic failure and relapse, because many times these patients improve and then 2 weeks later will come to you with a recurrence of UTI when you have to use the drug to which the pathogen is sensitive. But remember, if you have a patient who's highly immunocompromised or who is a neonate, then if you see such kind of report, it might be better to actually change to the drug to which the organism is properly sensitive. Now, another thing which you must understand is, let's say this case, this is a patient who comes to you with features suggestive of bacterial meningitis. The patient is started on IV ceftriaxone and vancomycin after sending blood cultures. But because the patient underwent a CT and all, the CSF was delayed. So CSF happened after the patient was given antibiotics. And the CSF is again like bacterial meningitis. And a panel is done which shows that it is pneumococcus. And what happens is 48 hours later, your blood cultures are positive, but the CSF cultures are negative. Now, this can happen because the blood cultures were sent when the patient was not on antibiotics, but the CSF cultures were sent when the first dose of antibiotic was given. So, as per the blood culture report, the pneumococcus which has grown is sensitive to penicillin and is sensitive to ceftriaxone. So, the question is, though we have started with ceftriaxone and vancomycin, if your pneumococcus is susceptible, you would de-escalate and give just ceftriaxone alone? Or would you give ceftriaxone and vancomycin? So here you must understand this important thing about pneumococcus, that the breakpoints are different for CSF and blood. So what happens is, because the concentration of the drug in the CSF is lower than that of blood, your cutoffs are different. So for example, for penicillin, whereas the cutoffs in the blood are 2, 4 and 8, in the CSF it is 0.06 and 0.12. Now, this patient, pneumococcus, which you have grown in the blood, has a penicillin MIC of 2. Therefore, it will be sensitive here. But if you look at it by the CNS criteria, it is resistant. And obviously, if this patient has pneumococcus in the blood, it will have the same pneumococcus in the brain. Similarly, ceftriaxone, if you look at the non-meningeal breakpoints, it is at 1. But if you look at the, you view it from the CNS, cutoffs, it is intermediate. So in this patient, you have to be very careful that though the lab tells you it is sensitive, you have to take it as resistant, and you would treat with ceftriaxone and vancomycin here. So important to remember that for pneumococcus, the breakpoints are different for CSF and blood. Now in this patient, if the CSF was also done before the antibiotics were started, then you would, you would end up with a report which would clearly tell you that the CSF isolate is resistant. Now you have this patient who comes to you with what looks like endocarditis, blood culture grows staph aureus, and it is a native valve endocarditis because the patient didn't have any valve problem. And look at the culture report. The culture report shows staph aureus, and it is oxacillin sensitive, and it is also cefoxitin sensitive. So this is an MSSA. So this patient, though there are so many drugs which are coming as sensitive, you know that for this patient, the treatment is either to use Clox or cefazolin for 6 weeks. And even though vancomycin is sensitive, you can't use it for treatment. So that means for every pathogen, you need to know the best drug for that pathogen. And you cannot just give any drug to which the organism is reported sensitive on the report. You have another child here, 7-month-old, with what looks like an acute bacterial osteomyelitis. And here, if you look at the pus, oxacillin is resistant. So this is obviously MRSA, and it looks like community acquired because there are many drugs to which the organism is sensitive. So what is important when you are assessing an MRSA is to look at the vancomycin MIC. And because if the vancomycin MIC is more than 1, then though the report will say that vancomycin is sensitive, you will have failure of therapy. So while you decide to use vancomycin, always watch out what is the vancomycin MIC. And then let us look at the last two cases, which is of gram-negative infections. And this is something which you will deal with on a day-to-day basis. So you have a 4-year-old child with a febrile UTI. The urine culture is sent and IV ceftriaxone is started. 48 hours later, fever is still persistent. and the urine culture grows E. coli and it is ceftriaxone resistant. So you know this is an ESBL. Now, this case is different from the earlier case because in the earlier case, though the E. coli which had grown was ceftriaxone resistant, the patient was getting better. So you decided not to change treatment. But here, the patient is not getting better. So you have to change treatment. So now, what are the options for treatment? You can use BL-BLI combinations like TAS. You can use carbapenems. You can use, and what about aminoglycosides? We'll discuss that later. Quinolones is resistant, so you can't use. And TMP-SMX is resistant. Otherwise, this would have been a good drug to use in this patient. So the question which comes is that how does a culture report help you in deciding between a BL-BLI or a carbapenem? Now, how to choose one of it is also dependent on the sickness of the patient. Because if your patient is very sick, you would choose a carbapenem. But it will also depend on what are the MICs of the BL-BLI. That means if the MICs are 8 or less, you can use PIP-TAS. But if the MIC is more than 8, you should not use it. And why? Because I told you earlier, this is the thing which I wanted you to see. Yes. So if you look at this, if it is 8, then this is 8, it means it is sensitive by both CLSI and UCAST. But if it is 16, then it is sensitive by CLSI, but not by UCAST, and you can have failure of therapy. That is why it is very important that decide on the basis of the MIC. And you cannot use amikacin as monotherapy here because you can't use amikacin for such a sick patient. Maybe later, if you want to switch to once-a-day therapy, you can give it. And there's no need to use combination therapy. So if you look at this patient's printout from Vitek, you know that the PIP-TAS MIC is 8 here. So that means this patient was not very sick. That's why we chose PIP-TAS. Remember that because this is coming out from Vitek, even if the PIP-TAS MIC was 16, it would have been said sensitive. But then if you find an MIC of 16, you would not want to use it. So that is very important not to just look at sensitivity or resistance, but also look at the actual MIC. And then let us come to the last case. This is a 7-day-old neonate, 1.5 kg, who's in the NICU, developed sepsis on day 7. Blood culture is sent, and as part of the protocol of the NICU, we started on meropenem and amikacin. The baby is slightly better, but 48 hours later, the blood culture grows Klebsiella pneumoniae. And look at the sensitivity here. If you look at this chart, amikacin is resistant, meropenem is resistant, colistin is sensitive, phospho is sensitive, TG is sensitive. So now the question is that the baby is better. So would you change treatment? Again, the same question comes. So here, this is not the case of a 4-year-old with UTI where you need not change treatment. This is a newborn, 1.5 kg, who can worsen very fast. And if you don't treat this infection quickly, it may go into the brain. So in this patient, if you have got this report which shows that there is carbapenem resistance, you should change treatment to an appropriate therapy. And how will the culture report help you in deciding that? You have to look at these things. For carbapenem-resistant Klebsiella, you have to ask the lab to do colistin susceptibility by broth microdilution because Vitek reports are not reliable. You should look at the carbapenem MIC because if your MIC is more than 16, then carbapenem will not help. You should look at the phosphomycin MIC also. It should be less than 32. Because even if the MIC is 64, the lab will call it sensitive, but phospho will not work. And you should look at the tigecycline MIC. Because if you see that the lab, any MIC of up to 2 will be called sensitive, 4 intermediate and 8 resistant. Whereas in real life, only an MIC of less than 0.5 or 1, you can use tigecycline, not if the MIC is 2, 4 or 8. So that is why you look at the Vitek printout. Now, if you look at this, colistin is sensitive, phosphomycin is sensitive, and the MIC is good. Meropenem, you see that the MIC is 8. So that is less than 16. So that may be one of the reasons why this patient improved on meropenem because the MIC was not more than 16. And tigecycline, the MIC is 0.5. So in this patient, because your meropenem MIC is not above 16, you can treat this patient with high-dose carbapenem and colistin. And if your patient is very sick or has CNS involvement, then you should use phosphomycin also in treatment, because phosphomycin goes well into the brain, whereas the penetration of colistin in the brain is not good. And if your meropenem MICs are high, the meropenem may not work. So that is why you have to start looking at the actual MICs. So I think with that, I like to end my presentation. I hope I've done it in the required time. And to say that, you know, it is important, not only is it important to send cultures, but also interpret them properly, and also not when to send cultures. I mean, don't send cultures of stool, don't send cultures from the ear, don't send throat swab cultures, don't send sputum cultures, which are actually saliva, etc., because they are not going to help you. Don't send cultures from indwelling drains, which have been there for a long time. Don't send swabs from open wounds. But let us say you have sent the proper culture, then you should interpret it properly. You should look at the Gram stain and the AFB stain. You should look at the other stains as well, like fungal stain, etc., which have been asked for. Look at the organism. Try and see whether the organism which you have found on culture is the culprit or not. And look at the sensitivity, and also remember to look at the MIC. Insist that your labs start doing Vitex sensitivity testing, which I think is now a norm in most cities. And also ask them to give you a printout of the MIC along with the sensitivity report, because in many labs, you know, the method, you can't write it on the report. So you can just ask them to print that MIC thing which comes from the Vitex machine and add it to the report. And then finally, treat the patient and not the report, because, you know, finally, if you have to choose between the patient and the report, I think the patient is more important. Thank you.
I think it was a wonderful presentation, Dr. Tanu. And I think you've summarized it very well. You've given a lot of practical points to us. That I am a pediatric intensivist, so it was wonderful to hear you. I would just like to add few things to it. Like, as we were talking about ETS spread, and you said that MDR or XDR, whatever is growing on, you just can't go on treating those MDR, XDRs. So I agree with you that the very important thing which one should remember is the clinical scenario. So it's not just the organism which needs to be treated, it is the patient which needs to be treated. So there are many scores. For my colleagues, I would like to tell them that there are scores like CPI scores, which tells you that there are some clinical deterioration in the patient along with the culture reports with the colony count. And then you interpret them, and then you treat the patient accordingly. So the most important things are the clinical scenarios, and then comes your cultures, and those cultures needs to be interpreted very appropriately as per the condition of the patient. And then talking, so I think the take-home message from today's Dr. Tanu's lecture would be to, we should start looking at the MICs. And that really helps us, especially in the critical care areas where you may end up using polymicrobial therapy for MDR or XDRs. So, you know, combining drugs or not to combine drugs, or, you know, complicated situations. So all those areas, so I think, so I just want to, and one more thing which I've just written it out is that UTI. So UTI is such a common scenario which, as a pediatricians, we see in and out. And every time it will be E. coli, which will be resistant to cefuroxime. And you would see that by the time report has come, the child has already responded to cefuroxime. And then the clinician will be, you know, taking the report and going from here and there, what to do with this report. So she has given us a good insight to it, that even if the cultures are saying that this E. coli is not going to respond to cefuroxime, but if the patient is getting better, we can continue with the same drug with some confidence. That's all from my side. Thank you so much, Dr. Tanu. It was nice hearing you.
Thank you.
Okay, Tanu, just one comment from my side. Thanks to Multitop, we keep on getting different organisms every day. As a neonatal intensivist, I can tell you that every day you are on rounds, get an organism which you have never heard of. And then you start looking at books at what is this organism, what is the sensitivity. So the microbiologists are making us run after the organisms now. And we have to learn a lot of things because the technology has really made us learn microbiology better now. Yeah. And your talk was excellent. I enjoyed it thoroughly. Thank you so much.
Awesome presentation.
Can I ask a question?
Can I make a comment, please? Excellent presentation, ma'am. And a lot of learning for us. And I think that one place where Mumbai scores over us is that Mumbai has you and we don't have you. This new platform comes to our rescue. Thanks. Thanks for your presentation.
No. I'm a Delhi girl. I'm a Delhi girl. You know, settled in Mumbai.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Tanu, I have a question,
ma'am. What is the most common nosocomial infection which we encounter in ICUs at present, according to present?
Klebsiella, I think, both in NICU and PICU. At least our top pathogen is Klebsiella, followed by Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas, E. coli, Enterococcus, and Candida. These are the main pathogens we are seeing, whether it's a PICU, NICU, or cardiac surgical unit.
Any sensitivity patterns to it?
So we find that the carbapenem resistance rates are very high in our hospital, like, you know, maybe 30% or so are carbapenem resistant. But yeah, one thing I would like to say that the resistance rates in pediatric and neonatal is lower than adult ICUs. In adult ICUs, the resistance rates are still worse. But still, we also have about 30-40% of our isolates are carbapenem resistant. And therefore, you know, if we have a patient in our ICU who has a nosocomial infection and is very sick, then our empiric therapy is colistin with meropenem till we get our culture reports back.
I think isolates in intensive care areas do differ as per the institutions. Like, we have more of Acinetobacter. And then, you know, Klebsiella is more common in hemato-oncology patients. So it do differ. But it's true that the nosocomial infections, carbapenem resistance has gone up. And that's really worrying. Not only carbapenem. What I am seeing nowadays is the resistance of colistin has also come up. And that is very worrying.
Yeah, so I think I removed that late, in the end. But beyond carbapenem resistance, now you have colistin resistance. But one thing I would like to say is when we find that our isolate becomes colistin resistant, we find that some sensitivity returns. So they become sensitive to some of the other drugs most of the times. So that helps. Dr. Kukreja, you had some questions, sir.
Yeah. My question was, anyway, very, very good presentation, very nice as usual, Dr. Tanu. And I kept the session in the last so that we can talk to you for 2 hours. Anyway, in the last case, Tanu, where you were having a carbapenem MICs of 8, will you also like to give a prolonged infusion of meropenem, which we normally practice?
Yes, you can do that. So you could use a higher dose and you could give it as a prolonged infusion. Yes, but you could give it over a period of 3 hours. In fact, that's a very good point because that is the real indication for giving a prolonged infusion over 3 hours. Now, what we have done in our ICUs is to give meropenem always as a prolonged infusion over 3 hours. We have made it a rule because what happens is that otherwise you tend to forget this. Ki isko 30 minutes pe dena hai, isko 3 hours pe dena hai. So at least in our adult ICU, we have a policy that if we are giving meropenem, we always give it over 3 hours because the carbapenem resistance rates are anyway quite high. But I also wanted to add that this isolate was an odd one out because we got a meropenem MIC of 8. Most of our isolates have a meropenem MIC of more than 16. And when you are saying what it is, you don't know whether it is 32, 64, 128 because the machine will not tell you what is the exact MIC. So more than 16, we don't know what it is. So that is why in those situations, using high-dose carbapenems or prolonged infusions will not help.
So here I have a question that as it is said that there is a synergism between meropenem and colistin. colistin improves the penetration of carbapenem. Is it true, Dr. Tanush? Shall we?
Yeah, that is true if your meropenem MICs are not very high. So this has been mainly demonstrated in Western countries where they have KPCs and they have meropenem MICs which are in the range of 4 to 8. But once your MIC is more than 16, this synergism doesn't really help. In fact, there is a study called the IDA study where they actually found that if you use for a meropenem resistant bug, if you use meropenem plus colistin, the outcomes are inferior than using colistin alone. So we don't know the reason for that. But now we have stopped using meropenem if our MICs are more than 16, and we always try to look for other companion drugs. Like in this patient, you know, you could have used fosfomycin, you could have used tigecycline, and you could have also used ceftazidime avibactam because that's also a good drug for carbapenem resistant CLEB. And our lab is now doing routine sensitivity testing for ceftazidime avibactam also.
So what is your experience with tigecycline?
So
My own clinical experience is not great with tigecycline.
Yes, so it is a companion drug and you use it when you have no other option because, you know, you have to give something with colistin and nothing else is sensitive. Then you use tigecycline, you use a higher dose. But the problem is in newborns and children, it's not approved and it doesn't achieve good levels in the blood. But we use it when we are desperate and there's nothing else to give, then we add it to colistin. But we don't know what is the additive benefit of tigecycline here. And we also have serious side effects because of the tigecycline. You know, your platelets go down, your liver functions get impaired.
So usually even my experience with tigecycline is not so great. And I would like to ask one more thing. I have added at few instances, I have added in acinetobacter infections, I have added rifampicin along with colistin. So, and I have found it that it do work well. So
it does, but you know, there was a randomized trial which came some time ago which showed that rifampicin does not add great benefit. But if you are pushed to the wall, and in acinetobacter we often use sulbactam as well, you know, because sulbactam, minocycline and polymyxins you use, and rifampicin. Like we had one patient with a post-neurosurgical acinetobacter meningitis where we used rifampicin. Yes, so if you are pushed to the wall, then you can add it even though the trial doesn't show benefit.
So I think we can go on and on because it's one topic.
Yeah.
Which is...
Final comment from Dr. Kukreja.
Yeah.
I think
there is one question from Dr. Chitkara. Can I answer that question? It's asking. So it says that good evidence to treat ESBL UTI with amikacin monotherapy if culture sensitive report shows amica sensitive and renal functions okay, spare carbapenems. So, you know, this I think I would like to disagree here, because if the patient is having a UTI, already the kidney function is compromised. Some of these patients may have a high creatinine. So, in such situations, I mean, though it would be more expensive to use carbapenems, more tedious to use them, still it would be better to use them rather than amikacin and produce nephrotoxicity. So unless, of course, the patient does not want to stay in hospital and wants to go home, then I would use an aminoglycoside.
Is there any vitro and vivo difference of E. coli to ESBL E. coli to amikacin, aminoglycosides? So that's what I used to understand.
Yeah, but again, as I said, that, you know, if you have it on the breakpoint, like you have an MIC of 16, you can still use it. But the problem is that there is no role of combination therapy here. So you can probably use the drug to which it is properly sensitive than use amikacin, unless, of course, you have nothing else. Like you have a situation where carbapenem is resistant and amikacin is sensitive, which can happen. Yeah, that is a situation where you would probably use amikacin and not use colistin.
Dr. Tanu, as a pediatric cardiologist, my interest lies with the endocarditis. And I would like to know that what empirical antibiotic you will suggest in a culture negative endocarditis.
So in children, the commonest cause of endocarditis is viridins group strep and staph aureus. These are the commonest causes, MSSA. And rarely you find enterococcus. It's more common in adults and not in children. So normally we use ceftriaxone with gentamicin or ceftriaxone, vanco, and genta as our empiric therapy for culture negative endocarditis.
Okay.
It becomes very tough.
Your choice also, that
Tanu, it becomes very tough to treat for such a long time with three drugs. So, for example, we had a child recently who had a MRSA infection and developed endocarditis. And then we reviewed the literature and we found that even the vancomycin can be given BD dose for a long period of time. We gave a BD dose and ultimately child recovered. One residual thing was he had a lot of thrombophlebitis or the venous vein thrombosis in his arteries and veins both. So that was the only residual thing and he was sent on warfarin. So this is a recent case. And we were surprised to have MRSA as a bug in endocarditis and we had to treat for something like 12 weeks.
That is more culture negative.
And it was right-sided endocarditis, interestingly.
So it's culture negative, this is what you would use. But if it is culture, then you would give definitive therapy. And in such a patient, you could even use daptomycin because that can be given as once-a-day treatment and it is as good as, vancomycin.
A little concerned, we are only pushed to the wall and then we use it. Because daptomycin, we have not too much of experience. We used in few cases only. We are very comfortable with the vancomycin.
How frequently do you...
Only thing is...
Vancomycin...
In a long term, after 2 weeks or so, or maybe 3 weeks, can we start with intramuscular ceftriaxone?
In fact, now, you know, there is a study which has been published in adults which have talked about IV to oral switch even in infective endocarditis. So if you have a patient who is well controlled, who is culture negative, who is otherwise stable, and you have an oral agent with good bioavailability and you have no option of giving parenteral therapy, then you could even switch to oral. So for example, in Viridin's group strep, there is some trial about using oral high-dose amoxicillin as a treatment, you know, after giving the first 2 weeks of ceftriaxone. So there is some data about that. So, you know, but what I would do is that I would treat every patient in the conventional manner, offer it as per the guidelines. But then if the family refuses, then I would go to alternative methods and not suggest them on my own. Because, you know, endocarditis, if there's a relapse or something, then you will always be held liable because you've gone outside the best protocol, clinical practice. Protocol.
Okay, Tanu, it was fantastic. We can go on for another 1 or 2 hours. It was a pleasure to discuss cases with you. And it was fantastic talk as usual. And we always take out time to listen to your talks. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Kukreja, for inviting me. It was really an honor. And I always love to talk to Delhiites because, you know, I belong to Delhi. In one way, I've studied.
Great, great.
Okay.
So it's nice to know that we own you. You belong to us. Wow.
Okay. So, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Dr. Singhal. It was a wonderful presentation, and everybody is saying so. And I think they have taken a lot of food for thought for whom, and it will definitely help in our patient management plans.
Dr. Tanu, we have continued for 1 hour.